1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're going to pick up the pace a little bit and move on, and we're going to begin at verse 35, okay, verses 35 and following. As you all well know, chapter 15 here in 1 Corinthians, largest section in Scripture addressing the doctrine of resurrection. What Paul is doing is, of course, he's identifying the error that sadly is spreading there at Corinth, and of course he provides corrective doctrine. Oh, it's so good to see Jan, by the way. Good seeing Jan. Very, very good. So anyway, so what Paul is now going to do, he's going to address two objections that are being raised, okay? And it begins here at verse 35, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35. But some man will say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die, and that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain, it may chance of wheat, or of some other grain. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body. So Paul will ask these two questions, and then he's going to supply, obviously, the answer to these two questions. Now, the way I understand Paul answering these two questions, verse 35, some man will say, how? I take verses 51 through verse 58 as answering the how. Although, obviously, in verse 36 and verse 37, he's going to supply some information regarding how as well. When Paul states, with what body do they come, he's going to supply that answer, verses 36 through verse 50, okay? What are the two objections? Now, the first thing we want to notice, look there at verse 35, but some man will say. Interesting, it doesn't state that someone is asking, okay? In other words, when some man, I don't take this to be a believer, the statement how and what comes from a heart of skepticism. In other words, this isn't sincere questions that are being asked for the purpose of desiring knowledge and understanding. Rather, these are statements that are being made in an attempt to ridicule, mock, and again, scoff the whole idea of physical bodily resurrection. Do you remember, for example, when the Lord Jesus Christ is being interrogated by Pilate? And he's asking Jesus Christ a series of questions. Who are you? Are you who you say you are? Are you what the nation of Israel say you are? And so on and so forth. And the Lord Jesus, he said, thou sayest the truth. And remember what Pilate said. He didn't ask. He saith, what is truth? So if you just think about the way someone, quote, asks a question, Pilate, he was dismissive. When Jesus said, thou sayest the truth, and then Pilate responded, what is truth? See, he made the statement, what is truth, not because he was a seeker of truth, not because he had a sincere desire to know the truth, but he just sort of dismissed the idea that there is such a thing as truth. So just keep that in mind. The objections that are being raised here isn't originating from a believer who's seeking information, but it really is a skeptic. And it's just a statement, how and what? Now, do you remember historically? Go to Acts chapter 17. Remember, in Greek culture especially, in Greek culture, the Greeks, they dismissed the idea of literal bodily resurrection. And we're not going to go through all of what's happening here at Athens. Of course, Athens, the principal city there in Greece. But Paul is in Athens in Acts chapter 17, right? And if you notice there at verse 18 of Acts chapter 17, then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him, Paul, obviously. And some said, What will this babbler say? Other, some. He seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus, notice, and the resurrection. Okay? So again, you understand Greek culture. They prided themselves with the great philosophers and so on and so on. Okay? So there are these philosophical systems that are going to challenge the idea, number one, regarding Jesus being a strange God, but specifically this idea of resurrection. If you drop down to verse 30, and Paul, of course, he's answering the skeptics. Verse 30, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. So the idea of resurrection was counter. It flew in the face of Greek thinking, Greek philosophy, the Greek system of wisdom. Paul calls it there in 1 Corinthians, of course, the wisdom of this world. So when we go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, again, I take Paul describing, quote, some man who is saying this. And remember, the Corinthians, they were falling victim to the wisdom of the world. They were gravitating towards the great philosophies and so on there at Corinth. And Paul is warning, obviously, the Corinthians. The first four chapters of 1 Corinthians, Paul is rebuking the Corinthians for being lured into the world system of wisdom, all right? So in verse 35, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, but some man will say, okay, here is the objections that are raised in an attempt to dismiss. It's cynical, okay? That's what's going on here. It's cynical. So it is interesting how Paul is going to deal with an unbeliever's skepticism regarding resurrection. All right, verse 35, but some man will say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? Notice verse 36, thou fool. Now, I don't encourage you to approach unbelievers and call them fools. So why does Paul answer by saying, thou fool? What that does is take us right back to Romans chapter 1. When Paul refers to this man, the skeptic, thou fool, what he's doing is he's exposing the position. He's exposing where this unbelief comes from. Go to Romans chapter 1. Notice there in Romans chapter 1. In light of creation, And that's what's going to happen. Paul is going to go to the laws of agriculture. He's going to bring up the laws of biogenesis to describe the how and the what of physical bodily resurrection. And so he answers by saying, thou fool. Remember Romans chapter 1, and if we begin reading there at verse 19 of Romans chapter 1. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. As far as God is concerned, the presumption is there is a creator. And if humanity would just witness the creative handiwork of Almighty God, God in creation bears testimony to a creator. So when Paul, he describes there at verse 20, the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, okay? So as far as God's concerned, you know, we don't have to engage in apologetics. You know, humanity can look at creation. I'll use the word nature, okay? The unbelievers, they don't use the term creator or creation. They would use the language nature. In fact, you know, worshiping Mother Nature, so on and so forth. If humanity would study, quote, nature, the creation, you begin to appreciate, quote, there is deliberate intent and design. Now, evolutionary theory, and our purpose is not to engage in what evolutionary theory proposes, so on and so forth. But the point is this. If you were to study science truly, Paul talks about science falsely so-called. Daniel was a scientist, okay? Adam, quite frankly, was a scientist, okay? If true science would lead you to identify the creator, false science is set up for the purpose of denying the creator. So some of the great scientists in human history, they were believers. I'm not saying they believed all the same things we believe. You know, they didn't dot every I, cross every T. But they believed that there is a creator. And you just have to appreciate the intricate handiwork of God, the precision in which the creation was designed. And I want to be careful using the term intelligent design, because that can mean different things to different people. When I say it, we know God is an intelligent being who creates outside of the dimensions of matter, space, time, and so on and so forth. Okay. So my point is this: true science will lead one to value and appreciate, again, the precision. And by the way, God in the Bible didn't divulge all of the mathematical formulas behind the work of creation. That isn't the purpose of the Bible, right? You know, God is looking for a heart of faith, a heart of belief, okay? But if you study engineering, math, sciences, and so on and so forth, you walk away just awed by how the creation was designed, okay? So with that said, verse 21, because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became what? Fools. That is how Paul is addressing the two objections that are being raised in the midst of the Corinthian assembly. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 35, when he says, thou fool, he's not, you know, just trying to humiliate anyone. He's identifying the source of the objection. The source of the objections arise from this rejection of the creative testimony and the rejection of the God that designed the creation. All right, so what does that all have to do with the issue of bodily resurrection? Now, just keep this in mind. Verse 20, the invisible things are clearly seen and understood by the things which are made. Okay, Paul is going to take us to the creation. Paul's going to take us to nature. He's going to take us to the laws of agriculture to supply an answer to the skeptic. If you stood back and you just evaluate the creation, we see death and life all the time. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 again. Just notice how Paul is going to treat the fool by going to creation to answer the objection. If the unbeliever would simply open their eyes and recognize, listen, the idea of resurrection is built in to the creation. Notice verse 36, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and look there at verse 36. Again, thou fool, same character, Romans chapter 1. That which thou sowest is not quickened except it die. And that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain. It may chance of wheat or of some other grain. So what illustration is Paul going to use? He uses the example of a seed, okay? Again, the laws of agriculture. And now this is really interesting. Keep your finger here. Go to Genesis chapter 1, and you understand we have, of course, the record of the creation, the, I'm going to use the term recreation, but anyway, regardless, Genesis chapter 1. It's rather interesting. The day God chose to create plant life, if you notice in Genesis chapter 1, and look there at verse 9, okay? Genesis chapter 1, verse 9. And God said, right, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together. Verse 10, and God called the dry land earth. Verse 11, and God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind. There are three principles in agriculture that are found in Genesis chapter 1. So when Paul says, thou fool, you, the skeptic, the objector, why don't you just study earth sciences? Because built into earth science are three fundamental principles that God established in Genesis chapter 1. Now, I want you to notice this. Again, verse 11, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the whole earth. The three principles of agriculture. Number one, death can never generate life. Only life can generate life, okay? Number two, life that is produced by the seed can only produce the same kind of fruit. In other words, if you plant apple seeds, you're not going to get bananas. You're not going to get kiwi, right? You understand. So number one, death can never generate life. However, life can only generate life. And secondly, the life that it generates has to be the same kind. By the way, what does the theory of evolution teach? That you can go from one kind to what? Another kind. That defies true science, okay? Verse 12, and the earth brought forth grass and herb-yielding seed after his kind, and the tree-yielding fruit. Here's the third principle in agriculture is, a seed doesn't produce another seed. What does a seed produce, ultimately? A tree, a bounty, a crop, a harvest, more fruit. Okay? Life can only generate life. When it generates life, the seed that generates life can only produce the same life within its kind, within its species. Thirdly, it doesn't produce another seed. It produces a multiplicity of fruit. Now, with all of that said, verse 13. And the evening and the morning were the what? Third day. Anything significant about the third day? Resurrection. Isn't that fascinating? When Paul uses the laws of agriculture, we find in the creation in Genesis 1, when God created agriculture, he created it on the third day. It's fascinating. Paul's going to answer the objection of resurrection by taking you to the third day of creation, which the third day is highly significant in all of God's word. Over and over again, God tells Israel, on the third day, I'm going to restore you. Over and over again, there's something about the issue of the third day. For our purposes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, today is supposedly resurrection day, right? And you understand, you know, okay. The third day is the, quote, resurrection day. So it's to me, it's fascinating. By the way, God will use agriculture so many times throughout his word to highlight something about resurrection. One of my favorite passages, go to Job chapter 14. So just sort of, God has a sense of humor, right? If you want to say it that way. Okay, you scoffer, you rejecter, you objector. Just study agriculture, and you fools, the unbeliever, you fools don't even know that I created agriculture and the laws thereof on the third day, which is a type of and representation of resurrection. The seed, Jesus, we're going to go there. The seed dies, okay? But there's something about that seed which makes it so unique. If God created agriculture on the third day, isn't it interesting? Whether it's corn, whether it's fruit, whether it's a vegetable, we see the cycles. You know the cycle. Spring is life, and then the summer, and then you have the harvest, and then you have the death of winter. And then what happens the following spring? Life. And it throughout human history, you understand, you have these cycles of death and life, death and life. And that's what's happening on the third day. God creates agriculture, and humanity doesn't take long to find out, you know what? The seed has to die in order for fruit to be produced, okay? So God has a sense of humor. If the unbeliever would only study true science, they'll learn a great deal. If you go throughout God's word, you'll see how often the Lord uses agriculture to communicate truth, especially in relationship to resurrection. For example, this is just one passage, Job chapter 14. This is a beautiful passage for me anyway. Job chapter 14 and verse 7. Look at Job chapter 14, verse 7. For there is hope of a tree, if it be cut down, that it will sprout again, and that the tender branch thereof will not cease. Though the root thereof wax old in the earth, and the stalk thereof die in the ground. So here we have an illustration. And, we had a tree in backyard. We had a tree that had to come down. It was cut down, okay? And sure enough, a couple of years later, all of a sudden, we saw something sprout out of the dead tree trunk. Oftentimes, you'll have new roots that begin to sprout. Look at verse 9. Yet through the scent of water, it will bud and bring forth boughs like a plant. Beautiful illustration. And by the way, Job is talking about the certainty of death, right? So now you got to appreciate what's happening in this chapter, verse 10. But man dieth and wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost, and where is he? So Job, of course, he's emphasizing the issues of death and the defeat thereof. But here's my point. So when that dead tree trunk gets verse 9, the scent of water. Now, what does water represent in Scripture? Remember what Jesus said? He said, give me the water to drink and so forth. And the young woman at the well gave Jesus, a ladle full of water. And then what did the Lord Jesus say? You know what? I'll give you rivers of water flowing out of what? Your belly. That's the Holy Spirit. So you think, why would God use agriculture? Listen, the Holy Spirit is a type of water. It's a type of revitalizing, refreshing renewal of the life that only God, the Holy Spirit, gives. And that dead tree trunk, at the scent of water, God, who intervenes on behalf of the dead, is the only source of life. But it isn't just a trickle. Jesus said, out of thy belly shall flow rivers. The Niagara River? That is a flowing river. We're not talking, a little, you ever been to Niagara Falls? It's pretty impressive, you know. And then if you go on those boats, you know, you spend thousands. I don't know how expensive it was, but you go and you wear that plastic garbage bag, you know, and you're completely drenched. But the enormity, the majesty, you see millions of gallons of water, and there is this flowing rush. When God gives life, it's not just a drop. It's this overwhelming gush. An overwhelming force of abundant life. Okay, so again, you can't help how God will answer the objector by saying, just study my creation and you'll see principles that I have embedded in creation. All right, again, thou fool. So go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I think, again, it's just fascinating. The laws of agriculture were instituted on the third day, which is a type of resurrection, in that the laws of agriculture and biogenesis will show that out of death springs forth life. All right. So notice how Paul is going to borrow from the laws of agriculture. Again, chapter 15, verse 36, thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened. Now, that's a beautiful old English word, the idea of quicken. Interesting. A farmer would never say that a seed is resurrected. But a farmer will say that a seed can be what? Quickened. Interesting, right? So there's a shade of difference in the idea behind something being quickened. It's to be not just brought back to life, but it's a life that is brought back that possesses inherently the force and the vitality of life. You see the difference? You know, God can remember what John said to those unbelieving Pharisees. He says, listen, and don't think that you can get away by calling yourself the children of Abraham. God can take these stones, those memorial stones in the River Jordan. God can take a rock and create a race of people. You know, God has that ability to restore life. That's the idea of resurrection. But to be quickened carries with it something more than just being brought back to life, but it's a type of life that is active. There's a force of inherent vitality and living, okay? So just appreciate the old English here. That which thou sowest is not quickened except it die. Go to John chapter 12. Go to John chapter 12. So here the Lord Jesus, he is going to teach a lesson in agriculture. John chapter 12. And notice there in John chapter 12, verse 23. John chapter 12, verse 23. And Jesus answered them, saying, the hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat. Now the word corn, it's the idea of a kernel or a grain, okay, or a seed. Well, if you want to call it a kernel or a seed or a grain, whatever. A corn of wheat, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth what? Much fruit. That's the third principle of agriculture. So let's think about, you know, some in the scientific community, they would say, well, you know what? That verse actually defies the law of biogenesis. We're not going to study. If you took a seed, is a seed dead or alive? It's kind of a trick question here, right? Did you know that the oldest seed that they ever found and they actually germinated, they found some seeds in Israel. They estimate that the seeds were 2,000 years old. Okay, 2,000 year old seed. Is it living? Is it dead? Is it alive? Does it have life? So the laws of biogenesis would say, well, you know what? There is something in that seed. They'll call it an embryo. They'll say all sorts of things. But again, the question Is the seed dead or alive? Now, science will say, well, it's not really dead, but is it really alive? So we get into this. So here's what the Lord Jesus is saying. If you have a plant, you have a stalk, when that kernel, that seed, that grain is cut off from the stalk, it's cut off from the plant, it is now severed and separated from the source of life and nutrition that the stalk or the plant is providing the seed. So death, in that sense, in fact, notice how the Lord says it in verse 24, except, O corn of wheat, fall into the ground. Death is separation. And the way the Lord Jesus is describing this is this seed is now separated from the source of life. And it falls into the ground. And that seed can lay dormant for a period of time, wherever it might be stored. Again, they found 2,000-year-old seeds. And they actually germinated it. Okay, I don't know if they made food out of it. I don't know. But the point is this. When the seed is in the ground, something has to happen to that seed. That seed has a shell. It has a coating. It has a covering. And via the process of time and water and temperature and so on and so forth, some seeds, by the way, they will never germinate until after a few winter seasons. Why is that? Because the freeze-thaw cycle actually breaks the coating. It has to die to itself in order for it to germinate. The germ of life contained in that seed will never spring forth unless it dies to itself. Some seeds will never germinate unless there's a fire. You have the great wildfires out in the West and so on and so forth. And, they find out after a horrific forest fire, within a few years, all of a sudden, there's this restoration of plant life and again, grass and agriculture. See, there are certain plants and grasses that will never germinate unless there's a fire. The fire or the freeze-thaw cycle actually breaks the coating open, which then allows this germ of life to spring forth. But the point is this, Jesus is providing a very accurate description of what's happening in agriculture. That seed must die unto itself. And then something happens, the germ of life. And now you have springing forth this life. You know, when we talk about the three laws of agriculture, death can't produce life. Life can only generate life. That seed possesses the germ of life. By the way, Jesus, he is the fulfillment of the first principle. Did Jesus not say, I am the way, the truth, and the life? See, the only way anyone can have life is by being sprung forth from the one who is life. Death cannot generate life. Jesus, he fulfills the first principle of agriculture. He is life. Go over to John chapter 17. The Lord Jesus, he fulfills the second law of agriculture. He is likening his death as a seed falling and dying in the ground. But you know what the result of his resurrection is going to produce? It's going to produce much fruit, an entire bounty. John chapter 17, notice there at verse 2. John chapter 17, verse 2. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give, here we go, eternal life. If Jesus is the sole source of life, life can only generate life. And as the life, the second principle demands that it has to be the same kind of life. If you want life, you go to the source of life, Jesus Christ. And the only life he could ever give to a believing sinner is the life that he possesses. And what kind of life does Jesus possess? He can only replicate his kind, his species of life. And according to verse 2, he should give eternal life to him, to as many as thou hast given him. Verse 3, and this is life eternal. First law, life spawns life. That's what Jesus is doing. Secondly, it can only produce the same kind of life. Jesus offers eternal life. But do you remember what the Lord says in chapter 10? Go to John chapter 10. He also fulfills the third law of agriculture. Boy, you didn't think we were going to study agriculture this morning, huh? You know, my neighbor next door, you know, it's still kind of cold. Is it cold to plant? Didn't it freeze that? I don't know. I see some people are planting. I couldn't plant anything. I don't even touch any of that. I thought if it's below the freeze, you might kill. Anyway, so I don't know. It just seems a little bit early to be doing all of that. But okay, it's spring, and we can appreciate some things about the laws of agriculture. But notice the third law, John chapter 10 and verse 10. John chapter 10, verse 10. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. That third principle of agriculture is that it isn't just eternal life, it's an abundant quality of life. It's a life that replicates the type of life Jesus Christ possesses, and it's a life that produces abundancy. It's fruitful. It produces a crop of godliness. It produces a crop of godliness, okay? So the Lord, he has no problem describing what he'll be doing in his role as Redeemer, likening it to a seed that has to die unto itself before life can germinate and produce. So go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Again, you know, agriculture, thou fool. Study the earth sciences just a little bit, and it will answer these objections that are, again, rooted in skepticism. You'll look at nature, quote nature, the creation, and you see the cycles all the time. So Paul goes on, and verse 37, and that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain. That's you see the word bare? You know what bare means, right? Naked, unclothed, nude. Okay. So in other words, that grain, when Jesus says it's got to fall and it's got to die, in other words, it has to decompose the seed. Now you know how he's going to link it to the physical body. What happens when we plant a body into the ground? You know, decay, decomposition. Bare, naked. In other words, that outer shell, the outer covering, has to die unto itself. As saints of Almighty God, we're a tripart creature, right? We're body, soul, and spirit. And the believer has to go through this bare grain process. The soul of the believer has to be naked. In fact, you see that word bare, right? Let's compare that with 2 Corinthians chapter 5, because Paul, he provides a little more amplification. You know, we need to be set free from this bondage. Paul's going to call it, we'll see that in just a second, bondage of corruption. We got to experience this state of being unclothed, bare. And for the believer, we got to break free from this outer shell, this sphere, this biosphere. God is the master ergonomic scientist, okay? He fits the creation perfectly in such a way that it is perfectly adapted to the environment, okay? We have to go through a process of decomposition and decay. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved..." Now you think about that word, dissolved. When you were kids, or maybe not as kids, you ever make a little mud house or a little mud pile? I did. I had nothing else to do. So I just did it the other week. Yeah. So you take a pile of mud, or how about a pile of sand? You ever do a sandcastle on the beach, right? And inevitably, you know, being young and dumb, you build this beautiful castle like at the edge of the water, and you know nothing about tides. And then what happens a few hours later? The water and that beautiful sandcastle, it literally begins to what? It just dissolves. And so the Lord's using just beautiful imagery here. We're mud people, aren't we? Adam was created from the dust of the ground, right? And so what God did was he just kind of formed a pile. Now, of course, he's an artisan, okay? He formed man out of the dust of the ground. We're really mud men, mud people. And one day, it's like taking the hose to the mud pile. And what happens to the mud pile if you leave the hose running long enough? Just like the tide starts to crash into the sandcastle, it just literally dissolves. It just disappears. The body, the dust, the dirt, it is just absorbed by the soil. So the language, verse 1 of chapter 5, 2 Corinthians, "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved..." And by the way, you understand the tabernacle concept in the Old Testament. It was just a temporary dwelling place, by the way, for God. Okay, that's the purpose of the tabernacle. It was portable. It was mobile. And the Lord did something fascinating. He instructed the nation of Israel to... wrap the tabernacle with badger skins and animal skins. By the way, never had a badger as a pet. I understand badgers are not friendly animals. They're vicious. Why would God tell Israel, "You take the skins of badgers"? Imagine the guy who had to catch a badger, you know. I don't know how he did it, but anyway. So the language... our portable temporal dwelling, this outward house, which is intended to house God, right? The original design, right? God created Adam in the image of who? God. If this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. "For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found what? Naked." So there is this language, verse 4, "For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up in life." We'll see. Back in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul's using similar language. So here's the point. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Listen, the physical body, it returns to the dirt. It dissolves. But there is now this state of nakedness. The body dies unto itself. And it has to die before there can be this germ of life generating itself. This process of germination taking place. Verse 38, "But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased him, and to every seed his own body." Now, that's pretty self-explanatory. You understand that. In fact, notice how Paul develops it, verse 39, all flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, and another of birds. Wow, he goes right back to Genesis chapter 1 again. Remember, thou fool, you unbelieving skeptic. You're just like that for Romans chapter 1 category of unbelief. And you know what? You're just a fool. You're just a fool. Look at creation. Obviously, the issue of a man or a beast or a fish or a bird, we understand that when God created, he created the creature so that it can function and fit the specific environment God intended it to function in, right? As a man, I won't last long in the ocean. A fish survives in the ocean. A fish can't survive on the land, and so on and so forth, right? A fish isn't fit to fly in the air. So what Paul's getting at, using the laws of agriculture, you know what? God is the one who designed the physical, fleshly, biological body to carry out the purposes that God intended that creature to perform. So as Paul is pressing the doctrine of resurrection, we're finding out that we as believers have to be free from this temporal, portable tabernacle of flesh, this earthly tabernacle. We have to be liberated, and that's a good thing. Verse 40, there are also celestial bodies, that, of course, reference to the heavens, and bodies terrestrial, but the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon. You know, there's tremendous diversity in creation. Yet, with diversity, there, of course, is the issue of specialization. There's the issue of functionality. In other words, the sun functions differently than the moon. The creation, the stars, the fish, all of that, they have different capacities, they have different abilities, they possess different characteristics, there are various resources available to them. Again, God, he's practicing ergonomics, and in his intelligent creation and design, he's fitting everything exactly according to its environment, all right? So Paul, he's going through all of that. Now, verse 42, so also is the resurrection of the dead. Now, keep reading. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in what? In corruption. There are five specific characteristics in relationship to the resurrection body God is promising to the church, the body of Christ. The issue of corruption, go over to Romans chapter 8. This is a great passage, Romans chapter 8. And notice how Paul here writes, Romans chapter 8 and verse 20. Romans chapter 8, verse 20. For the creature was made subject to vanity. Now that's important. God deliberately determined everything's going to die. Now remember the reason for that. Why would God, verse 20 says it, not willingly, the creation never asked to die, whether it was Adam, whether it's a tree, whether it's a star, everything in the physical realm ultimately dies. But notice the language, verse 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him. So God had a reason to sentence creation to the penalty of death. And that was genius on the part of God. Because remember, sin entered into the world, right? And death by sin. When sin entered into the world, that is the point in time where Adam surrendered the crown of glory that God gave to him, and by surrendering it, he forfeited it to the serpent. So you just think about God's reason in declaring creation to fall under the penalty of death. So here's Satan, who now has authority, and God says, it's as though God hands him creation, and it's all dying in his hands. Isn't that a good thing? Imagine if there was no death, and now the creation is under the operational control and the governmental influences and the governmental operation of Satan, and nothing dies. Now we got a big problem here. It's almost like God saying, all right, it's yours, but it's all going to die. You're going to rule over a creation that's subject to death. In fact, that's exactly what the Bible describes, that Satan, he had the power of death, okay? He had the authority of death. So, verse 24, the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him, God had a reason, who has subjected the same, notice, in hope, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of, there's that word, corruption. So Paul, when he begins to describe the type of body, what body is the believer going to possess? He says, well, you know, it's sown in corruption. And of course, the whole concept of corruption, the whole creation is subject to death, decay, decomposition. And for the believer, that's exactly what happens. It's subject to corruption. Now, if we keep reading, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God, for we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves. It hurts. Travail. There's pain. We experience the agony. Whether it's by disease, whether it's by injury, whether it's by, quote, old age and the process of decay and so on and so forth. There's pain, there's agony, there's this groaning. It hurts. It hurts being a part of a sin-cursed creation and falling under the sentence of death. Verse 23, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves. You always think about, you know what, keep it to yourself. Did you catch what I just said there? Where are we supposed to be groaning? Within ourselves? It's a joke, by the way. Keep it to yourself. I mean, it's okay. You want to groan and complain and murmur. No, it's okay. But you know, it's kind of interesting. We groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. Okay, now, obviously, that's the hope that God gives to the believer. What kind of a body? Well, listen, it is planted into the ground. Go to Job. There are a number of verses in the book of Job that describes the corruption. And interesting things, our present physical body in Job chapter 17, it is vile, it is putrid, it is defiled. Our present biological bodies, corruption. In the Old Testament, God likened leprosy to corruption. Anything that was maimed, broken, bruised, blind, crushed, scabbed, blemished, the spot of leprosy, you know what God said? That is corruption. This present body, it is a corruptible, foul, putrid corruptible mess. And it's going to go into the ground, and notice how Job would describe the results of all of that. Job chapter 17, verse 13. If I wait, the grave is mine house. I have made my bed in the darkness. I have said to corruption, thou art my father. To the worm, thou art my mother and my sister. You know exactly what he's describing here, right? The worm. You know what happens to these bodies of corruption? The worms. Go over to chapter 19. Chapter 19. Verse 25, chapter 19, verse 25. For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God. So the point is, okay, you know what? It has to die unto itself. It's okay. Let it go back to the earth. Let the worms feast and enjoy that rotting carcass. Paul says it's going to be raised how? In incorruption. The future body that God promises the church, the body of Christ, to each and every individual believer, it's going to be a body that will be pure, chaste, clean, holy, untainted, unspotted. It's going to be a body that will never bear the taint of corruption. Incorruptible bodies. Paul said it is sown in dishonor. You know what it means? Dishonorable. You know, in the military, you've got dishonorable discharges, right? When something is dishonorable, there's no value, there's no worth, there's no dignity, there is no respect. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Here's the type of body that God describes for the believer. The reason this present earthen vessel is planted in dishonor, because this present tabernacle houses sin. You know, you talk about the house of horrors. Paul says in Romans chapter 7, I know that in me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth what? No good thing. No good thing. It is a dishonor. And because it is a house of sin, it is a house of spiritual horror. No dignity. No dignity whatsoever. Now, notice how Paul contrasts that. Verse 43, it is sown in dishonor, it is raised how? In glory. If our current physical body is a dishonorable, unworthy, disrespected carcass, you know that one day our physical bodies will house glory. Our physical bodies will be admired, adored, valued, respected, esteemed, and literally the envy of the universe. It is raised in glory. And there's a whole lot going on when we learn about a new body that is a body of glory. There is something that God is installing into these heavenly places, and the creation, they're going to witness something about this body of glory. It is, Paul says there in verse 43, it is sown in weakness. It's weak because it's subject to death. It's weak because it has no authority. It has no power. It has no means of stopping death. But it's going to be raised how? In power. There's a real important thing here. Go to Ephesians chapter 2, and we're going to finish up Ephesians chapter Ephesians chapter 1. This current body is weak. By the way, Jesus was crucified how? In weakness. Acts chapter 8 says that that was his humiliation. This physical body, it's humiliating. It's a humiliation to God, this original biological tabernacle, right? It's weak. It has no authority. Do you know that we're going to possess a body through which God is going to exercise authority? And real quick, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power? So when a body of power, in what sense? You know, I mean, as a kid, you think about jumping buildings and whatever. Wait a minute, a body of power. In other words, we're going to possess a body through which governmental authority is going to be exercised, okay? And so we read in verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. There's this issue of power associated with the resurrection of Jesus Christ, but it's the right to reign and rule, verse 21, far above all principality and power. So this power of resurrection has to do with this capacity far above principality and power. Verse 22, and hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. In order for you and I to be an eternal extension of the rightful authority of Jesus Christ, when God raised his son up from the dead, he raised him up in a very special and unique way that allows him now to exercise governmental control throughout the heavenly places. And oh, guess what? We're the fullness of him that filleth all in all. We're going to be, by extension, exercising power. Go to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. The power, how the means by which we're going to share in authority. We got to have a body that is specifically designed and adapted for that coming environment. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, for our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, it's corrupted, that it might be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working, that was Ephesians chapter 1, whereby he is able even to subdue all things. We need a new body so that we can participate in the subjection of the heavenly places under the rightful authority of Jesus Christ. We'll stop. Paul then is going to talk. He's going to describe Jesus is a quickening spirit, and we'll see the difference between a quickening spirit and Adam's living soul, all right? Father, we do again thank you for your grace and for your love. We again thank you for that hope that you give to us through your word regarding that future resurrection body so that we can participate in all that you're going to carry out throughout eternity through your son. We thank you for that hope. May it sustain us. May it comfort us. May it strengthen us. May it also encourage us to carry out the work of the ministry that you've entrusted to us. And we ask these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.